Welcome back everyone to another video. And in today's video, I'm gonna be talking about arrays and how you can use them in code to take advantage of not having to keep track of so many variables, and it'll make things a lot easier. So let's get started. Don't forget to hit the like button and subscribe to the video if you guys end up liking the content. So in the past, we've collected from the end user, let's say their name, and we've declared variables of type string, right? And we've said like, my name is, or we've outputted a name. My name is Bob. But what if I have multiple names? Let's say I'm gonna hold a program that's gonna keep track of all my employees. So let's say I say employee one, their name is Bob, right? Let's say list of names. And then I'm gonna have to declare another variable for employee two, and their name is John. And then employee three is Mark. So on and so on. Employee four, whoops, is gonna be April. This is already getting a bit annoying, and as you can tell, boring. And this is gonna be hard to manage because as I, you know, take into account further programming and I utilize these names of the variables, the names of the variables throughout my program, I'm gonna have a hard time keeping track of all these names. What if I have 100 employees? Well, we can go ahead and take care of this and store all these names in one variable using an array. So how do you declare an array? It's gonna be the exact same thing. We're gonna say, hey, this array is gonna be of type string because we're gonna go ahead and store names. But the only difference is you're gonna go ahead and add an open and close bracket to the type. And we're gonna say that the name is names equals. And then if you already know the values, it's pretty easy. Just use the open and close curly braces and then semicolon. And inside the curly braces, we're gonna go ahead and input the values. And each value is delimited by a comma. Is separated by a comma. So in this case, it's John, Bob, Mark, April, and we have Beth. Okay, these are all my employees. Let's take a look. How many employees do I have? Well, in this case, I have 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. I have 5 employees. If I want to know how many employees are in the array, I can actually find that out with a property that's called length. Okay, so you type the name of the variable and then dot length, and it'll actually let you know how many, ready, elements are in the array. So every single value in here is called an element. So you'll often hear it referred to as, what's the first element of the array? Well, the first element has a value of John. And so we can see here that it says 5. The length is 5. That's because we counted 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. But how do we actually access the values? Well, if you want to access the values, you're just going to go ahead and type out the name of the array and then open and close brackets, and we give it the index of an element. Well, what's an index? Well, an index is a number representing its position in the array. The only difference is index count starts at 0. So we've heard that we count with a starting point of 1. Arrays have a starting point of 0 for the index count. So in this case, we want to go ahead and access the first element, and that'll be names, and then the index of 0. Let's go ahead and run our program. And there we go. We see that John is rendered on the screen. That's because John is the first value for the first element of the array. We've gone ahead and indicated that we want to know what the value is of the first index by indicating the index of 0. So let's go ahead and make this a little easier. And let's go ahead and create a variable that's going to be called index. And this will store the index that we want to always access within our array. So let's go ahead and run that one more time. And we see John again. Nothing new here, not surprised. We knew that it was John because we went ahead and said it was zero. So the last element of the array is Beth. We know that that's an index of 4. Let's run that one more time. And we see Beth on the screen. What if we were having an integration with an API system that gave us an array of employees and we had no idea how many employees there were? Let's say it gave us more than 4. Well, we wouldn't know which one of the elements was the last one. And let's say our boss says, hey, use this API, retrieve the employees, and I want to know who the last employee in that array is that's being returned by the API. We wouldn't know that the last index was 5. So how do we access that? Well, let's take a look. Let's create a variable, last index equals, and remember, we were able to get the count of how many elements an array had with the length property. And that is, that is useful. So we're going to say names.length is going to be returned as. Let's go ahead and output that. The array has a total of plus last index elements. Let's run this and see what it does. Okay, the array has a total of 6 elements, and I missed a space there. Okay. The array has a total of 6 elements, and our last output is Beth. Well, we know that because we supplied that as the index of 4, but the number of elements is 6, but we start counting indexes with 0. So let's see what happens if we try to just supply the last index. And in this case, it's 6, even though we have the last index of 5 because the count starts at 0. Let's see what happens. This is what happens. We get an error, an exception unhandled, system.index out of range, exception. Index was outside the bounds of the array. And so that's exactly what happened. This returns 6, and so it's counting as 6 elements, and we can see them in memory there. And so pretty much the program said, okay, so 6, an index of 6. Let's go ahead and do 6. It doesn't exist. It's out of bounds. Okay? So what you want to do is you want to go ahead and say minus 1. Because we always start with the count of 0, and let's give it another try. Stop the program. And there we go. The array has a total of 5 elements. That statement is false now. Let's just say the array's last index is, let's get rid of this. Let's run the program. And there we go. So we've gone ahead and found out what the last index of the array is by taking the length of the array, which counts the total number of elements, minus 1, because we know that the index count starts at 0. So it's always going to be less than 1 of the total number of elements. In this case, the array slash index is 5. And we've gone ahead and said, hey, console.writeLine names, and we supplied the last index. In this case, it was 5, and the value is mark. And that's how you access the values of variables. Of array variables in C#. Well, can you reassign the value? Of course you can. Let's reassign the last index value. Let's say Mark went ahead and quit his job. We're going to go ahead and say names, and we're going to supply the last index. And we're going to say that Mary was hired. Okay, let's run the program one more time. We can see that the array's last index is 5. We know that, and it outputs Mary. And so in this moment, we see that line 17 had a declaration with values of index 5 holding the value of Mark, but we reassigned that value in line 21, and that was to hold the value of Mary. And we can see that that is correct because that was outputted to the screen. So that's very, very cool. Last but not least, I'm going to show you how you can go ahead and output all of the names using the for loop that we learned in the last video or so. So how do we do that? Well, let's get rid of all this. Oh, let's say for each string name in names. That's all we got to do. This is actually a for each loop. And we're going to say console.WriteLine. And we're just going to say name. And that's it. So we're saying for each, and then we specify the variable. We're going to say it's a string. We're just going to call it name in names, which is our array, console write line name. Okay, so every time it's accessing an element, it's going to store the value in name, and then we're going to go ahead and output it to the screen. So let's give that a go. And you can see, you can see all the names: John, Bob, Mark, April, Beth, and Mark. Very, very easy. So it does all the counting for you. You don't have to worry about it. For each, and then string, name, and names, and then console write out, write line. Let's do it the old way from our previous video. We're going to go ahead and say, we're going to start off with integer 0. And we're going to say I minus, for the condition, names dot length, because we need to know how many elements are in the array. And then we're going to increment it by 1 every time the for loop is executed. We're going to say console write line, and we're accessing it the exact same way that we did before, by indicating the name of the array and then the index. In this case, though, is the index is the variable I, which is being used by the for loop. And as long as I is less than the length of the number of elements in the array, in this case, it's 5, then we're going to go, in this case, it's 6, we're going to go ahead and output the name. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. Let's do that again. And we get the same result: John, Bob, Mark, April, Beth, and Mark. But let's add the counter. Let's say I plus concatenate that there. I think that's called a colon, if I'm correct. So you can see the element number there, or the index, the index of the element. So 0 is John, 1 is Bob, 2 is Mark, 3 is April, 4 is Beth, and 5 is Mark. And that is how you use arrays. Very, very cool, right? Last but not least is, if you did not know the values from the very beginning, you can actually declare an array by just saying new, and then the same is the same type, which will be string, open and close brackets. But inside the open and close brackets, you're going to go ahead and type how many elements that array is going to hold. In this case, it's 5. Let's go ahead and assign let's say names 0 equals John, and the rest will remain empty. Let's run the program again. You can see 0 holds a value of John, and the rest are empty. Those elements 1 through 4 are actually empty. Not until we assign values like we did for the first one will they hold a value. And this is when you have to declare an array with values that will be filled in later in the program. The count's still the same. Everything is exactly the same except for the values. So you can see now Mary, the element index of 1, holds the value of Mary. Okay, very well. If you guys liked the video, hit the like button and subscribe to the channel. Until next time, let me know if you guys like this content. If you have any questions, leave them in the comments. Have a good one.